Hello, how you doing? I'm Craig Parkinson. You are listening to the Two Shot Podcast. Sit yourself down, pop the kettle on. We're going to have a nice old chat. Who's it with this week? I'm going to tell you right now. How the devil are you? What, Craig? Two in one day? Well, come on, it's a very special day. You know, this is our very first Two Shot Podcast birthday episodes. You just listen to, maybe you're going the wrong way around, maybe it doesn't matter, there's no right or wrong way. Charlie Cooper was this morning, and now we go to Manchester and sit down with the Reverend himself, Mr. Jon McClure. Now, I'd never met John up until a year ago, while we're talking all things a year. I was at Kendall Corning Festival, and he just finished his set on stage, and we went for a drink, and having a right good old natter, and I approached him to come on the podcast. This was when the podcast was just an idea. I don't think I'd even had the pleasure of meeting producer Griff yet, so yeah, it was very early days. But we got talking. It was a very easy conversation that flowed. I thought, yeah, we'll have a sit down with John. That'd be fantastic. He's always honest. He's always got an opinion. He's always got something to say. And he's a grafter, and I love him to bits. And I'm so chuffed that he came on. Now, we met in Manchester. Myself and producer Griff had a very busy day recording, if I remember rightly, because it was quite a while ago. And John was late. He was going to a house party. Not what you think. Anyway, we talk about it on the podcast. Him and Ed, the guitarist, they go to people's houses and they do a little acoustic gig in the garden. It's brilliant. And John and Ed were late because there was a car crash. They were coming over from Sheffield, so they got stuck in a load of trouble. I don't think anybody was too badly injured, which is good news. Anyway, they were a bit late, so it was slightly shorter than what I'd hoped, but still, always a pleasure to sit down with him, always a pleasure to talk to him, and I think it's going to be a pleasure for your ears. This is Jon McClure, episode 51 of the Birthday Two Shot Podcast. Enjoy, and I shall see you at the end, so to speak.
I was in the car with my wife the other day, and we'd just finished listening to Death of a King, and I was saying, imagine going over there to Thailand and recording. What made you go over there? What does a band do to go over there? What's the point? Is it cost or
it's cheap. Libertines had been there, and they're friends of mine, and I linked them up with my manager like a few years back. They didn't have a manager. I says, get my fella. So anyway, they went over there, and then they come back. We'd been supporting them on tour, and they were like, oh, you've got to come. It's mint. I've been to Thailand before, and it's just a great... Other thing is, if you record your album in your shed in Sheffield, in your little cupboard like what we've got, it gets boring, doesn't it? Oh, I've done another album in Sheffield. Everyone's like, so what? Whereas the moment you say, I've done it in Thailand, people are like, ooh, are they? Have you? So there's a bit of that, like a bit exotic, isn't it?
Did you record it over there first? Or, yeah.
Yeah.
So did you write it over there?
Bits. A lot of it. We had ideas for songs and had it worked out what we were going to do, but bits we wrote over there, yeah. Like, it's hard, isn't it? Because I don't want to, like, culturally appropriate, but equally you want a little vibe, don't you? You know what I mean? But because it's a little bit 60s sounding, I can't do India, because then you're just doing Beatles, aren't you?
Yeah.
And I'd like, there's a right nice studio in India, actually, up that way, Shimla kind of area.
Oh really?
Yeah, up Darjeeling, that sort of way. There's a right nice studio in Hills, but I can't do it, whereas Beatles never really touched on Orient, did they? So I thought I'm on safe ground here, you know.
Well, because we were talking in the summer, weren't we, about what you were studying once. But I want to go back, like, to the beginning for you at school. Okay. What was home life like for you? Because there's you and your brother and who else?
Me and my brother, my mum and dad. That's it? Yeah.
What do your mum and dad do for a living?
They both were, like, they're kind of semi-retired now, but the mental health nurses, like, look after, like, mentally, you know, people with learning disabilities and stuff.
Yeah.
My brother does a similar thing, and that's kind of family trade, really. I'm the only one who's never done it.
So where did the music come from, then?
My mum were a club turn, like, she were a singer in a group called the Scorpions. But there were another band called Scorpions, didn't remember that?
Yeah, Wind of Change.
Oh. The path. All that, yeah.
She didn't cover that.
No, she never covered that, but My dad's music man, really. He loves tunes, but my mom's like, she always likes to sing and all. So we're always about, we're always in house.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So, yeah, musical house, really.
And what was school like at primary school?
Yeah, a bit naughty. But just typical northern working class stuff. You know what I mean? My dad went to the pub. My mom didn't. But then she did at weekend. And then, like, yeah, just typical, like, obvious northern, like stereotypical northern kind of working class thing, really.
And what's the age difference between you and your brother?
4 year.
So did you go to the same school?
Yeah, same school. He followed me all the way through, like, and that. But he's like my best mate. He's a top lad. You know, he's a bit of a legend in Sheff. Bit of a boy around town.
Yeah.
But it's just me and him, and like all brothers do, we scraps and
make up
all that. And I could punch him, but if anybody else does, I'd want to kill him. Like, but yeah, and I think, like, that's why Oasis had such a big impact, because where we lived, around where all my family lived, there were loads of Jamaicans. I was always into reggae and dancehall and that growing up and all that. But when I got to like 12, 13, Oasis come out, and that just changed everything. So we're like, how about you talk a bit like we do and a bit scummy like we are, and you scrap with your brother like I do. And tunes are mega. I'll have a bit of that. Like, so yeah, got well into Oasis, and that through that, you know, you're off, aren't you?
And when did the music thing really come in, that you thought, actually, I'm going to try and have a career of this?
Oh, actually doing it myself, not till like after school, because Eddie, who was a guitarist, he were always in bands at school.
And what were you doing in secondary school then? What was your passion there? Or did you just sort of kind of fuck school off a bit?
I did until right at end, and then I got dead into it. And like, my GCSEs are terrible, but my A-levels are like all A's. I got it dead into like being clever. And I had this one teacher who like got hold of me, and he's like, if you don't, you're a clever lad, you, but you're going to end up in a bad place if you don't like sort yourself out. So a bit of a tow rag. And then I proper got into it, and I went to uni, did an history degree.
What were you doing in your history degree?
I did the decolonisation of the British Empire. So
I know that for people who are listening, but I just wanted to hear it.
That's why I
again.
Loved Indian Summers. Yeah, that's what I did on my dissertation. I did that subject, like, and all that period is what I studied and what I wrote my dissertation on. It's a bit geeky, but I loved that program for that reason.
What were you hoping to achieve with that? Or was it just something you just thought, I've got a real passion for this, I'm really interested in it, or do you not think that far ahead?
I kind of fancied writing books about history, really. That's what I always envisioned. Not even that. I think a lot of people go to uni, don't they, thinking, I'm going to be this. And I just did it because I really wanted to know about all history at world and all that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And, you know, I just, like, I'd enjoyed it immensely, but I always had. I was starting to do music then, and I had it back of my mind doing music. And by end, I ended up like working in a factory and in this call centre, and not really doing out with my degree. I'd got my degree and it were there, but I never, for a couple of years, I never did out with it. It was just, I'll just work in factory or work in call centre because I don't have to care about this job.
I can just
sort of toss it off and just.
Just take the money and run type of thing.
Yeah, I used to work for Norwich Union, and I used to just get like my work on this computer and then like send it on this internal system to like someone in Norwich, and then or bury it in. I used to bury people's insurance companies in system, and then just make out I'd done it all and like not do any work all day. I were awful, really.
That's like when I used to have a paper around when I was a kid, and there used to be a penny of paper, and I used to just get loads dump delivered to your house. Just dump them in the woods or leave. I used to have a garage like full of them.
Me and my dad used to do that, but then they used to start sending this bloke round. But we knew what road you used to check up on you on. So we'd just deliver it to that one road and then just lob cart rest off to woods, like, no drama.
So when did the band first start forming? What was its first incarnation?
We had a band called Jude and Suki.
And who was that? You and?
Me, Eddie, Laura, my wife. Cheryl, who's my cousin, she's not my cousin, she's like that Peter Kay cousin, you know, that your mum's friend's daughter.
Friend of the family.
Alex from Arctic Monkeys, Elders, who were drummer. Our guitarist, Eddie, might possibly be out there. I'm just worried that he's going to be on his own.
Should we open the door?
Maybe.
We can just cut all this out.
That'll be all right. Was it this?
I don't know, fucking awful.
Rock bitch, innit?
So awful.
All of it. Like,
some of the. There was a feed coming through here before. My God. Griff, when. Even if you were 15, you'd be embarrassed about writing that and putting it out.
Some right shit about it.
Yeah.
Where's he got me on, I'm looking for it.
Have a look. Yeah. You got it?
Is he a night? Yeah. Have you met Craig, get it?
No.
Just pull up a few Eddie Hoods, sorry.
Sir, I came, I was looking for them.
It's all right. Come and sit down.
Sorry. What were we saying?
The more, the merrier. I think we were talking about the first incarnation about how you all met and got
me,
together.
Eddie, my wife Laura, but she wasn't my wife at the time. We both went out with other people. Cheryl, who's my cousin, but not really my cousin. Alex, who's in Arctic Monkeys. Matt Elders, who's in Arctic Monkeys. A lad called, what he called, drummer, Paul Olden. No, he was bass player, and then there was a lad called Matt drumming. But we were absolutely bobar. Terrible.
What kind of stuff were you doing?
White funk.
Like white funk?
Shit white funk, yeah, like rape bad. But like trying to be a bit political and all. And then we had this other band. Like, then we got into like, realised that we couldn't be that funky. So we got into like punk funk, you know what I mean? Like Gang of Four and stuff. We started to get a bit more credible. Got a bit more, better taste in music. We had this band called 1984, which were just me and Eddie. It's like called Carl Kelly. And a lad called Chalky. And that were a bit of a mad group. Carl were an interesting fellow. We once did a gig with Arctic Monkeys in their practice room and a big fight happened and Carl were a raster and had this big gold tooth and it got hit out. He got knocked unconscious by this pool cue. There's a Monkeys song when he's on about fighting with pool cues in your hand and that's what he's on about.
Right,
and
yeah.
My memory of Carl is just getting absolutely knocked unconscious with his pool cue, which were a bit mad. But 1984 were better. So there were Judan Suke, rubbish. 1984, better, still not perfect. Then I started to do Rev thing, kind of like me, and then like me and Eddie, and then just my mates had come down to the studio.
Was that just something that just came into you?
Yeah, just a new thing I'd got going.
And a new...
Like I'd got, Andy from Monkeys had given me this nickname, ready, like, oh, you're the Reverend. He used to call me the Reverend. And then it kind of spread a bit, and then I just started doing tunes with like all my mates used to come down to me studio where I were. And that's kind of how it was born, really. It was more of a studio thing than a band at first. And then subsequently, it just took on a life of its own, and here we are.
And how was it when you first started as Reverend the Makers, and we were unsigned? How did you get to be the first signed band?
We just put some tunes on the internet, and it kind of... I'd have got a bit of a rep already in Sheffield, and Monkeys thing were happening, and it was just an exciting time for Sheffield.
When they were starting to sort of blow up as well?
Yeah, they were kind of starting to play big, starting to, like, you know, actually get real fans rather than... just the mates coming to watch them and stuff. We just whacked some tunes on the internet and a similar thing kind of happened. Then there was another band, Milburn, and another band, Bromage Jacket, Little Man Tate, Long Blondes, and it just, there was this scene happening and everyone were into tunes at the time.
Yeah.
And it just kind of went from there, really. And we didn't play, everyone else were gigging, but we just got us some tunes on the internet. But everyone loved, like, the idea of this project had started. So we did a gig and it was busy straight away.
Right.
And from there, it just kind of flowered after that, went a bit mad for a bit, you know.
And who first signed you?
Wall of Sound, Mark Jones, they call him. They were like a dance label, released like loads of mad stuff like over the years, like Wise Guys and Roiksop and all that sort of stuff. And he loved us because I think he's dead into that Sheffield electro thing. You know, Sheffield's home of British electronica, isn't it?
Really? Yeah.
Cabaret Voltaire and all them, and he loves that side of our music. And I suppose that's what made us stand out from Monkeys and Milburn and the other bands who were about guitars, where we were about guitars and synths a little bit. And
yeah.
It was a bit of a different thing. And yeah, we signed to them and made his album, and obviously then Heavyweight happened and that sort of changed everything, really.
And were you still signed with them when that happened? The state of things?
Yeah, we were already popular before they signed us. We were doing 1,000 in his hometown, no problem. And there were loads of labels after us, but a lot of labels wanted us to, like, just be Arctic Monkeys, you know?
Yeah.
That shit. I love them, but I don't want to be them. I'd never wanted to be them. Like, always wanted to do my own thing, and I still do my own thing. And that's why we could have got more money and probably been more successful, but it's not... I don't know, it's a bit shallow, that, isn't it? You know what I mean? Like, I don't just want to copy people. I want to be my own man. Because, like, Alex were in my band, I weren't in his band.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I don't want to like copy what he's doing. I love him and I think he's amazing. But
and they do what they do, and that's
yeah,
great.
Yeah, he's amazing at it, you know. And like, sometimes I think, oh, it'd be amazing to be as popular as him. Then other times I think, well, I can go to my mum's for my Sunday dinner. Like, we aren't anybody giving up. I get a bit of grief. Obviously, I get a bit of grief, but not compared to what he gets. And then equally, I can make a living. I've done all right. I've got a nice house. I think, yeah, I'm all right. It's good, you know. Life's all right.
And you're still happy and still being creative, I suppose.
Yeah, and it's for whatever reason, a lot of bands who come out in our time frame are dead. They're gone. They're finished. I don't know what's happened to them. And we just seem to got our biggest show in November we've ever done in Manchester. You know, it's albums we've just released, second highest we've ever had after the first one, obviously. But it just seems to be getting like if old more popular, you know, which is mad, isn't it, considering we've been doing it 12 years.
Yeah,
but great, you know.
And also there's so many bands though that you like, we were talking about, oh well, they sound like them, they're the new that, or they're the new this, where the ones that really make it and carry on, they're them, they're their sound, even if they reinvent their sound, like I think you guys have done.
Yeah, we just do what we do, you know. And I think, like, I quite like them artists who just have always ploughed their own furrow, you know what I mean? I think, is that the right word? Ploughed, can you, do you,
yeah.
Do you do? Plough your furrow, yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I've been doing, ploughing my furrow, yeah. And, yeah, man, I just, you know, long may it continue. We get to, like, not have to get up and, which in Sheffield's a big thing, to not have to get up and go to work on a Monday morning.
Yeah.
Like, our Chris is going to work. He works at hospital. Our Tommy works on bins. Like, they're texting me, like, oh, I'm at work and all that. And I'm, like, laid in bed. And I think, I'm blessed, aren't I?
Well, it's funny because usually on this podcast, we always have a lot of actors. And then because we're in 2018 now, we're doing lots of sort of creative types. And I was talking to my wife, and she's at a bit of a crossroads with her acting at the moment. And she's... What actors, you may or may not know, what actors don't have? They don't have any control, really. They can't just get up and write a song and go and record it. You're at the beck and call of everybody else. And you go, God, I wish I could have like a musician's life. Because even if nothing's happening, you can still be creative within yourself.
I see it a bit because my wife's father were a West End actor and his son were also a West End actor, like musical theatre and all that. It's not a world I know anything about, but equally, like, he's getting it up now, my father-in-law, but, like, you know, like, months and months we're out of role. And he's, like, thinking, is it ever going to come again? You know, the problem we have as a musician is there's no, like, long-term security. So if bang goes on its arse in 1, 2, 4, 5 years, all right, I've got to have enough money to blag it for a couple of years, but then I'd have to get a job, so there's no pension, none of that.
Well, it's the same as an actor,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So really, like, you just kind of... And I like that. I'll tell you why I like it, because I feel challenged to create more... good art, you know what I mean?
I
think, like, all right, well, like, I'm into it because I'm not dependent on anybody, it's just me, me and him, and me and Eddie and Laura, or me and my band, whatever.
Yeah,
but I don't have to, like, and like you say, you're not at anyone's beck and call. I think I can just do it off my own hustle.
And also, if you write a song, you don't have to give it to someone and go, actually, well, John, I don't like this lyric, can you change that?
No.
Whereas, you know, something, if we write something, then it's got to go through about 20 different people who maybe don't even know what
we're
doing.
We don't sign record deals that where record labels telling us, like, no, our record label we've got now, we've released, this is a fourth album we've just released for them. They're not telling me, like, take that song off your album. You know what I mean? They're just like, right, you're releasing it, that's it.
That's it.
And I like that because I think, like, I sometimes think, like, a moderate level of success is best because you ain't got that pressure of staying at top.
Yeah.
But equally, you can make a living from it. So you're just in middle. It's probably the same with acting to some degree. If you get like plenty parts, you're doing interesting stuff, you're doing good roles, but you're still making a couple of quid. I reckon you're doing all right, aren't you?
Which is the thing about what you were saying before, you know, you've got your people texting you going, I'm at work. Like what we do, it ceases to become work, even though we're grafting and we're earning money, but it's not work because we love what we do.
And I think it's always relative and all, like, in your head, you could, all right, it'd be nice to be like George Clooney, wouldn't it? But
no. Right, me?
Yeah.
No.
All right. So let's say you were that famous. All right, on one hand, mega.
Yeah.
But on flip of that, you can go and have a pint round town.
Yeah.
Like, people know you're off at telly and off of films, of course they do, but equally, like, you can live your life, can't you?
Yeah.
And you can, to some degree, choose what you do, whereas, I think if you're like Tom Cruise, you've got to do action movies, won't you? You know what I mean? Or if you're Coldplay, you've got to play in a football stadium.
And you've got to keep on going at that level, otherwise someone's going to be disappointed or someone's going to think that, oh, well, they're not as good as what they used to be because they're not doing that
and
anymore.
And that's it. You're almost like working to order then. Like, musicians get to this thing where they're like writing to order. I've got to maintain my status.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Whereas I'm like thinking, well, I'll just do what I want. Make it up to go along. Somebody will like into it. And they do. You know what I mean?
Yeah, of course.
So, like, happy days.
Because after this, you're going to do another house party, aren't you?
Yeah, we're playing in Middleton tonight, me and Ed.
How did all that come about? When did that start?
I don't know. I've always played daft gigs. I go outside with guitar after art shows. So this time I'm asking buskers, if you're coming to a gig, I've got a guitar, let me know, and you can jump up and play my guitar outside after with me. And, like, it's just something a bit different, isn't it? Like,
yeah.
I think in days of social media and that, mystique's gone. You can't be like Brian Jones, like, levitating somewhere. You've got, so the only thing you can do is go other way and be like hyper real.
Yeah.
Do you not understand what I mean? Like, I'll come to your house or stand in your front room.
But I think they do the fans really appreciate that, I must admit.
They do, but there's a lot of nutters. They either want to fight you or fuck you. You know what I mean?
Have you ever any bad stories?
Yeah, some shockers, yeah. Went to Wales, because all the way to Wales, it's like a blowing a gale. Fucking
yeah.
Terrible weather. The idea is, you're going to win a, let's say you're a fan, right? And you're going to win a gig, and then you're going to get all your mates in your house, and you're going to ram it, and then I'm going to turn up, and they're all going to love it. Mega. 30, 40 nutters. Smash your house up. Go home. I don't do pubs. People are like, will you play me pub? I'm like, I'm not doing house gigs because I'm struggling for a gig. I'm doing it because it's interesting.
Yeah.
So I don't do boozers. I don't do weddings. I've got a few rules, right? But I don't do. Turn up in Wales. It's a gale. My mate's driving me around in like a camper van. Like a Breaking Bad thing.
Yeah.
So I'm just sat on back bed smoking my bud and he drives me about. We're in this gale. Gets to Cardiff. Meeting this kid who's won the house gig, right? Who said, I'll put house gig on. So I meets him and he's disabled. So I thought, I don't want to be a knobhead to him, but because he's disabled, you know what I mean? I'm not an arsehole. So I went, come on, follow me. So follows him into a pub. I'm thinking, come on, mate. You know I don't do boozers. So he sits down, he's like, what do you want to drink? I'm like, oh, fucking Jack and Coke, pal. Anyway, comes back. I'm like, listen, mate, not being funny. Why are we in a boozer? Where's everybody else? He's like, oh, there's nobody else.
What?
He says, what do you fucking mean there's nobody else? He says, I just love your lyrics and your poems. I just wanted to spend some time with you. Fuck that. Out at back door, like a yard, in like a terraced house yard, like Coronation Street yard.
Yeah.
Me and my mate, shinned up wall, off at back fence, fucked off back to Sheffield.
Oh my God. Don't want God. It, do you? No.
But you know, you're like, I think you meet all kinds of humanity doing this. I used to do two a night at one bit. I've done one in Whitehaven. End terrace on this cliff overlooking sea in Whitehaven, and the nutters. They're all crowd surfing in the living room. Somebody's gone through front window. Coppers have turned up in like Black Mariah. We're like, fuck this, off, right? Then we go to the second gig in Ulverston. Rate pad, proper posh. I think they got like an indoor pool or something, baking their own fucking bread. In the same night, you know what I mean? Like, I had a proper insight into like British class system. I love it because I think you're just meeting every kind of person, aren't you?
Yeah.
Know? So happy days.
And they carry on now. You're still going to do, you're going to stop those now before you go on tour.
I keep them going a little bit because the way I look at it is, as media's clogged up with like Chris and Kem off fucking Love Island, yeah, our media's chock full of bollocks. It's at a point where real music, I don't mean real music, I don't mean you have to play guitar by real music. I mean people who are talented, who are genuinely talented and doing
and care.
And are doing artistic things and trying to push the music a bit. Becoming marginalised. So my thing is, there's a lot of people from 90s or 80s musicians who cannot get their head round the new reality and therefore are gone.
Yeah.
Or even from noughties, they can't get their head round how it's not the same anymore. You can't just sit on your arse, make a record every 2 years and everything will be fine. You've got to be interested in doing it and tweeting and all that bollocks, right? So my thing is, like, if I play an house gig in like fucking Wigan, they're talking about it for like 2 years after. When Rev come round to his house, it was mega. And you get a lot of loving arts of people then. And I think that goes some way to explaining why as gigs are getting bigger, not smaller.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? 12 years in. Do you know what I mean? Because it's a bit weird. It don't really happen. Everybody's record sales go down shit and we just kind of cruise on like mid-table every season. And I think that's why, really. Because we just try and do interesting shit.
Yeah.
So happy days.
And because you are a close band, obviously, because your wife's in the band that. What happens when... Is there any fallouts in the band?
I can be a rape prick. Eddie will tell you.
Is that true, Eddie?
Can I be a prick?
Well, you know.
I used to be a rape knob. Like, a bit too... like, you know what I mean? Like, just on one all the time.
Yeah.
I've calmed down a lot now. It was a bit weird for a while, because when we got together, me and Laura weren't together. I had a girlfriend. She had a boyfriend. And we split up with his partners, and we got together... And then we split up and I went back out with my ex, but I didn't want to sack her out at bangs. I'm not like a fucking sexist pig or old, you know what I mean? I thought, yeah, all right, she's a good musician. I can't sack her. I'm not a knobhead. You know one of them, like, you're not shagging me, so you're sacked. That don't work, does it?
No.
So she was still in band, but they used to call it like Rev Enders because it were dead dramatic, you know what I mean? We were still basically in love with each other, you know what I mean? So, but then we got back together, got married, got two boys. Me and him even get on now. And I've known Eddie since I was 11, right?
Oh, did you meet at school?
From completely other ends at City. Now, right. You can listen and get a vibe off us and make out which end, who's from what end.
I can already tell anyway, right. It's easy.
See what I mean, right? But...
He's had a wash.
Right, there you go, right? Opposites attract and we just clicked and we've been good pals all the way through and it's me and him who do it all, really.
Yeah.
Laura contributes, and Joe as bass player and as drummer, of course, but me and Eddie are kind of engine room at band, really, and always have been, and it just works. You know, and I feel like we could make fucking 20 records. I don't feel like we've made his best one yet, which is a good place to be.
It's a great place to be, isn't it? When you finish an album, though, do you go, yeah, of course you're happy with it because you're putting out, but do you ever go, when you listen back to it, maybe a few months later, you go, yeah, I would have changed that.
No, not last two. Last two were as good as anything anybody's done for a long time.
So I agree.
The fourth one's a bit shit, and the reason it's a bit shit is because we're trying dead hard to make some music that we thought at the time would get on the radio, which is not a reason to make music.
Because you were striving for different things at that
time.
Yeah, I
don't like that fourth album. It's a bit try-hard, whereas last two albums, nobody's making records as good as that, and that's a very arrogant thing to say, but it's true, man. I think there is the problem we have is not that people don't like the last two records, it's getting them to listen to the last two records. And once they hear it, they love it.
Yeah.
It's just how do you... And that takes time. That takes time. It has to... Oh, fuck, that's right good. Have you heard this? Have you heard that? And it's just that, and it's working. It's bit by bit. Every tour's bigger. This album goes higher in charts than the last one. Just takes a minute, but I'm cool with that. I'm not starving. Everything's nice, you know what I mean? And I think...
You're still happy? You're still enjoying what you're doing?
Absolutely, you know, and in between that, you get to do interesting things. We're doing some music for a film. I'm making a TV series. Like, we're gonna do lots of other interesting shit, and you can mess about and go different
countries. I was going to say, if you weren't doing this, what would you be doing? But obviously, you just want to be creative in any aspect.
Books, I think. I'm writing a novel and all.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, same future, like a bit of a fictional kind of political thing. It's good, but might be bollocks, but... You know, I'm in a position where if I can do certain things and a certain amount of people are always going to be into it.
Yeah.
So that gives you confidence and it gives you an enormous amount of freedom. And I think that's when people do the best. You know, there's this like, oh, you've got to suffer for your art thing. I'll be fuck. You've got to be like happy as fuck, like being free. That's all you've got to be. Do you know what I mean? All this kind of, you've got to be a miserable bastard's bollocks, I think, really.
John, that was fucking brilliant. Cheers, mate.
And our last birthday episode is done. Jon McClure, what an absolute pleasure to spend time with the Reverend. I hope you enjoyed listening to it. I hope you enjoyed listening to Charlie and to Jon. And in fact, to the year's worth of guests and podcast episodes that we've brought you this year. It's been an incredible experience. I'm not going to waffle on. I think I did enough of that at the beginning of Charlie's. But look, thanks for listening, for downloading, supporting, subscribing, the Patreon backers who give us a bit of money every month to support the podcast. If you've liked the podcast that we've been putting out for the past year, just think, if everybody who downloaded gave £1, we would be able to carry on making podcasts for quite a long time. If you fancy getting in touch, because we are a truly independent podcast. We haven't got sponsors. We're not part of a bigger network. We do this all off our own back. But if everybody gave £1, well, just think, drop us a message, drop us an email. You know, we're on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram at @twoshotpod. And our email is twoshotpod@gmail.com. Here's a bit of other news. Look, you know, I've been going for a year. And the year has been fantastic, but we're going to take a little summer break just to rest our mouths, rest our ears. You can go back over the back catalogue of the year, go listen to another favourite one if you want, but we will be back after summer. We're going to start recording again in August, so not that long. And you never know, there might be some surprise episodes coming your way very soon. So look, a huge thank you to everybody. And until August or so, I've been Craig Parkinson. He's been Producer Griff, the brilliant Producer Griff. And this has been the Two Shot Podcast. Take care, have a lovely summer, and I'll see you in a bit. I'm just waiting for some music to start. Happy birthday to you. Two Shot Podcast is presented by me, Craig Parkinson, recorded and produced by Thomas Griffin for Splicing Block. Our music, our brilliant music, is courtesy of Them Thickens. Cheers.